Hey friends, Azure Cosmos DB is a globally distributed database service for building highly available, scalable, and fast applications. Developers who use it obviously care a lot about maximizing its performance. Deborah Chen is here to share some strategies to help you get the best performance from Azure Cosmos DB for reads and writes today on Azure Friday. Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman and it's Azure Friday. I'm here with my friend Deborah, who's going to teach me how to make my Cosmos DB databases better.
Hey Scott, so happy to be here.
Yeah, absolutely. So people bump into some different problems when they're using Cosmos. Mm-hmm. And maybe these are problems that they can optimize and fix, and you've got some demos for me.
Yep, exactly. So what I've taken is some of the most common issues people run into. Mm. We'll demo what it looks like when you run into them and how you actually fix and address them.
Okay, cool.
All right. So the first issue people run into when they're doing operations against Cosmos DB, especially queries, mm. is they run a query and it takes longer than they expect.
Sure.
So like, what's going on? How do we fix it? So for example, here I have some sample data that just shows I have a bunch of users who have reviewed a bunch of things on a retail website.
Okay.
So a ton of JSON data here. And let's say I want to write a query that says, get me all the reviews for a certain user.
Cool.
All right, so I have a query, but when I actually run it using our SDK in Visual Studio, I see it's taking longer than expected.
Right.
So we'll run this one. Okay, and it's supposed to print out the result and say how long it took, because I set a stopwatch on it. But you can see it's taking quite a long time.
It hasn't finished yet?
Hasn't finished yet.
Yeah, that's not good. That's not good at all.
Yep. So what's going on here? So it finally just finished. We timed it. It took around 14 seconds to return around 800-ish results. That's pretty slow for a query. So the first thing you want to check when you run into this case is, did you set your SDK to read and write from the right Cosmos DB region?
Mm.
So here I have Cosmos DB set up in three different regions,
okay.
West US 2, Southeast Asia, and East US 2.
Cool.
So let's make sure that I've configured my app correctly.
Right.
I'll tell you right now, this VM is running in West US 2.
Okay.
So I go back to Visual Studio. I check out the initialization for my Cosmos client. It's up here. And you set this application region.
Mm.
And we see you've actually set it to East US 2. So now that explains the latency, because we're basically going back and forth across the side of the country. So if I comment this out.
And that's something you should let Cosmos worry about, not your app, right?
Yes, exactly. As long as you tell us where your app is, we'll take care of the rest.
Cool.
All right, so now let's rerun this using the correct region. Oops, forgot to close the old one.
All right.
Run it. And now, that would finish pretty quickly.
Yeah, it was like
less than two seconds.
Okay, cool.
All right, so that's issue one. Make sure you're reading and writing to the correct region.
Mm-hmm.
The other important thing to note here is pretty basic, but if you're doing any type of perf testing with Cosmos DB, make sure you are doing it in Azure, an Azure environment.
Mm-hmm.
If you're doing it on your local dev box, all your testing is a distance between you and your closest Azure data center.
Right, you're limited only by the speed of light.
Exactly.
And even sometimes not even that.
Yeah. All right, so that's issue number one. The next issue we run into is when people see their queries consume more RUs than they expect, and they run into rate limiting or throttling.
Mm.
So are you familiar with how the Cosmos DB provision throughput model works?
Well, I know that there's a unit,
mm-hmm.
like this RU, and
yeah.
that it's kind of an abstract thing. Like
mm-hmm.
I'm sure it's concrete for most people,
yeah.
but it's abstract in my mind. And there's a slider bar
mm-hmm.
attached to my credit card, and the more RUs I have, the more I have. Right?
Yeah, exactly. So it is an abstract unit. The way to think about throughput is you tell us how many operations per second you need expressed in terms of throughput
mm-hmm.
Per second, and that's what Cosmos DB gives you.
Okay.
So each operation, read, write, query, takes a certain amount of RUs. This query in particular took 123 RUs.
Okay.
So that's actually pretty high. So if we provisioned, let's say, 1,000 RUs per second for this collection, I could run about 7 of these queries a second.
Yeah, I would need, I want,
you want more,
I want
right?
way more than that.
Yeah, and if you're going over that limit, that what you've provisioned, you're going to see rate limiting, which you'll see, or throttling, which
okay.
you'll be able to see in the portal. So we obviously want to avoid that.
And throttling means it'll happen, it's just not going to happen right now.
Yeah, it'll just be a bit slower, which
okay.
is, of course, not what you want. So now let's debug why this query is consuming this many RUs.
Okay.
The first thing you want to check is what is your partitioning strategy you've chosen for your collection.
Mm-hmm.
Cosmos DB, what it does is you tell us how you want us to distribute your data among all the machines that we have that store the data.
Right.
What you want to give us for read-heavy scenarios is you want to tell us exactly which machine your data is on so we don't have to check all of them.
Uh-huh.
And the way you do that is via your partition key. So in this case, let's just first check what we've partitioned this collection on. All right, so if I go to my scale and settings for that collection. I see I've actually partitioned on ID. Okay. But if you look at my query, it's a select star where username equals something. Because we are partitioning by ID, Cosmos DB has no idea which machine has the username with this, so it has to check all of them.
Okay.
If I told Cosmos DB is partitioning by username, it would just go to the one machine with all that user data and skip all the other ones.
And is a partition key a kind of index, or is it an index?
So the partition key is not quite an index. It's just how Cosmos DB chooses to distribute your data.
Okay.
So there's a ton of underlying machines. You say, if I partition by username, all the data with the same username or a partition key value is on the same machine.
Okay.
So that's how to think about that.
And can I partition based on multiple things, or do I only get one?
You get one partition key, but the content of that key is really up to you. So okay. We'll see more about that in a later demo.
Great.
All right, so let's check what happens if we change partitioning key strategy here. Mm-hmm. Instead of partitioning by ID, which gives us what we call cross-partition query. By the way, one analogy I like to use a lot, which I think helps, it's like imagine you go to a party or event and you leave your phone there. Mm-hmm. It's a difference between knowing, oh, this person has my phone, I just go straight to that person, get it from them, versus if I don't know who it is, I have to check every person, do you have my phone, do you have my phone?
Yeah.
It's the cross-partition case.
Makes sense.
That's what we try to want to avoid for read-heavy scenarios if possible.
Cool.
All right, so I have that one container partitioned by ID, but I have a second container with the same exact data, only this time it's partitioned by username, which is actually what we're querying about.
All right,
so now let's run the same query, but we're actually going to run it against both of these collections. So you can see the first one, that was the one we just ran against V1, consumed 123 RUs. Mm-hmm. But the second one against this V2, partitioned differently, consumed only 62 RUs.
Like twice as efficient.
Yes, exactly. So with the same throughput, we've now doubled the amount of operations we can run, just because each one is cheaper.
That's really significant. Mm-hmm. I mean, this small change, in quotes, is a massive change because you've effectively doubled the effective throughput if I was doing a lot of this query.
Exactly. So definitely a partition key strategy is always something you want to check. Make sure you've got a good one there. We have
cool.
a lot more content on choosing a good one, but that's just like the quick 1 minute
totally.
Spiel. All right, so the next issue we see users run into is that they use queries when they really should use point reads. Mm-hmm. So I'll explain what those mean. Queries are good like these when you know you're going to get tons of results back, or at least more than one. In contrast, sometimes with a database, you know, I have one user profile, I just want that one piece of data, it's unique, one document back. So you could do a query that says, get me all the user profile where username is X. But you could also just directly tell us, here's the ID of the document, here's the partition key value. We skip the query engine entirely and just give you the document back.
Cool.
So let's see the impact of this. This is my third demo here. Okay. So here, first, I ran the query, consumed around 3 RUs. By the way, this is returning one document, right?
Yeah,
user
that's
profile.
Like nothing at all.
Yeah. But the thing is, if you look at this one, the point read, and let me show you what it actually looks like in the code here. Right. So here we do the query and then we run the point read, and the point read is just doing a read item async, looking by the partition key and the ID. So it took one RU to do the same query, get the same result versus the point read for one query is 3. So this may not seem like a lot, but if you're running at scale, you have thousands or millions or hundreds of users on your site at once, with even 10,000 RUs, you could run 10,000 of these per second, or you could run around 3,300 of these.
And one RU, like there's not fractional RUs. One is it, right? It's atomic, isn't it?
Yeah, so this one happened to be one. We do have the, I guess, doubles, like we could get like 0.5, 0.8. But this one is very clean.
But still, that's like a nice clean, it did the least.
Yes.
And if you do nothing, you can scale infinitely.
Yeah, that's a nice way to put it.
Yeah, thanks.
All right, so that's another nice optimization you can do.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
All right, so I have a couple more. We mostly cover these for read-heavy scenarios where you're doing a lot of reads and queries.
Sure.
But of course, the database, you also write data to it as well.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, what is the database really doing?
Exactly.
So the next most common issue we see is people say, I've provisioned a lot of throughput because I know I'm going to write a ton of data.
Mm-hmm.
So here I have a collection here that says, where I've actually partitioned 50,000 RUs per second, which is pretty hefty. The reason I'm doing that is because I know I have a website, I'm going to see what everyone is doing on each of my product pages, and every time a user clicks or looks at it, it's going to generate a lot of volume of data.
Wow.
The issue they run into is they provision this throughput, but then when they actually do the ingest, they don't get the whole amount. Mm-hmm. So it's like, what's going on there? So let me actually show this in action. Okay. So this is just some sample data I'm generating that kind of mimics what you might be looking at if you're like tracking activity on a site.
Cool.
And I'm using our bulk executor library to simulate high ingested data into Cosmos DB. So I'm running it. And it's supposed to print out exactly how many documents was able to write, how long it took, and then how many effective RUs per second was getting. And as you can see, this one is still going. And you'd think for 50,000 RUs, you would get that pretty quickly. So we were able to get only around 69 or 7,000 RUs per second effectively for ingest, even though I provisioned 50,000. Right. So what's going on here? Where is the rest of my throughput?
I don't know.
Right.
I mean, I'm thinking. Mm-hmm. I'm thinking about locking and simultaneity and all. I mean, my brain is reeling about all the things that could be wrong.
Yeah. So Cosmos DB actually is lock-free. But what you want to investigate again is your partitioning strategy. What is that here?
Okay.
So when you have a write-heavy workload, the most important thing you care about is having high cardinality or lots of unique values for your partition key. So in this one. One collection here, I've partitioned by date. So if you think about it, today's date, everyone on the site has the same value for a date, and you're all going to be bottlenecked on the same partition.
Right.
So there's a ton of machines waiting to serve results, but they all go to the same one. The other ones can't really help you. Mm-hmm. So instead, what you want to do is pick a partition key with high cardinality, lots of different values. If I go back to my data, we see I have this product page ID, as well as the timestamp.
Right.
So what I can do is I can actually create a new property called partition key, where I let's show you here by partition. Too many collections here.
No worries.
Partition, just say partition key, and set it so it's just concatenate the page ID with the timestamp.
Oh, so you're generating a partition key of your own.
Yes.
You're creating one synthetically.
Yeah, synthetic partition keys. That's exactly what we call it.
Cool.
And it's nice because there's a ton of different unique values for the product page, and now timestamp every day will be different. All right, so now let's rerun the same demo, but let's run it against the collection partitioned correctly and see what throughput we get. And wow, it's actually getting more. I think the rate limiting hasn't hit in yet. It should. If I were to run more iterations, it would get slowly closer.
Because you only paid for 50,000?
Yeah.
So for a moment there, you were living the dream at almost 90,000. That's awesome.
Yeah.
And like a second.
Yeah.
That's huge.
Yeah. So
these
again,
10x improvements.
Yeah. So same data. All you did was change the partitioning strategy.
Wow. That is making massive changes in a very small, little change here, little change there.
Yep.
And you weren't getting 10% more.
Right.
You were getting double, triple, 10x, orders of magnitude.
Exactly. So those are just some of the top common issues we see customers who are new to Cosmos DB run into, especially in the areas of performance. Hopefully, they now have some more insight into, when they run into them, what they can do to debug and fix those issues.
This is super useful. Thank you so much.
Cool. Thanks so much.
All right. I am learning all about how to debug and optimize some performance issues with Azure Cosmos DB. Be sure to check out all the other great Azure Friday videos that we have on Cosmos DB. I'm having such a great time today on Azure Friday.